have one chance of doing this.
I do.
Okay. Yeah.
Speed rolling and action.
Come visit us at the official Xena fan club site,
www.creationent.com.
Good. One more.
Opposite. Hi guys, come and visit us at the official Xena website fan club. Hi guys, come and visit us at the official Xena fan club.
www.creationint.com.
That'd be three W's.
www. Let's do that again.
She's terrible. www.creationint.com. Hi.
Again.
Hi guys, come and visit us at the official Xena fan club.
www.creationint.com.
What? Three W's.
I said www, didn't I?
No.
Oh, everybody's a critic.
Hi, guys! Hi, guys. Come and visit us at the official Xena fan club.
www.creationint.com.
Easy for you to say.
Check time code here very quickly. Good? Okay, blue box?
Yep.
Hang on. This one. Hey Sharon, come on in.
Oh no,
what you got there? This is your era, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah,
these
it
are
is.
Songs when you were.
These were songs when I was growing up and I was in kindergarten, no, college.
Cool.
The 60s, the radical 60s.
Nice. We put this together.
It was a fun time. You guys were a generation behind me, weren't you? No, ahead of me. No, behind me.
But actually, Cher reintroduced us to this.
Ah, to the Shoop Shoop song.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Of course she did.
I almost brought her version, but I thought I should go
well,
with the originals.
Welcome to the slumber party.
Yeah.
Yes. You done with your toenails?
Music.
Everyone's all painted?
Yes.
Yes?
Uh-oh. Oh, God. If I could get rid of this foot rot, I'd be fine.
Left over from Xena. Mm. So, I brought some questions that I could ask you guys.
Shoot.
I'm not going to show you what they are.
Shoot, diddy what?
And seeing as we're a bunch of girls, I thought we'd do hair talk first.
Hair talk.
Like...
That's our favorite subject.
We sit around and talk about.
We're different colors.
Okay, first.
You're learning to use hot rollers?
Are you?
Yeah. Don't stop telling my secrets.
Let's hear.
I didn't wear any today, but I'm practicing all that stuff. I remember my mother used to always have rollers in her hair and one of those blowing machines where you wear the hat and it sort of blows it all up, that sort of mushroom on your head.
I'd love
so
to
I've
see
got
that.
One.
Yeah. Oh, that's great.
I know. It's nostalgia.
So, wait a minute, you put like the are they hot? Are they metal or something? And then you put the bag over you and you
Yeah.
That's great.
Sorry.
I love that. Yeah, I was wondering about that.
Oh.
I don't
have
that
problem.
Yeah,
put the bag on your
great.
Head. You don't
My problem with yeah, just let it roll. We're actioning. I was gonna say the now that we're back, now that we've plucked the microphone out of Renee's
your
cleavage.
Top. It was drowning in there.
It died.
In there. It's back.
Is the only thing with having good feet is you just keep hiding them. Shoes, socks.
What happened to sandals? You
sandals.
Know? Come on, thongs.
We are in California, aren't we? Can you do the Vulcan salute with your feet?
I can grip a tree with my feet.
I know. I can pinch a person with my feet.
I can cross all my toes.
I can write calligraphy.
Okay, so we're back with hair, and we've got different colors and different lengths and different shades.
And everybody thinks it's such a revelation, don't they? When I do interviews now, they like, oh, you've got a new look. And, well, I've actually been like this for a while, but yeah.
You're letting it
it's
grow?
It's nice cut. I like it. And the color's pretty. Really.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It, sometimes it photographs a bit brassy and kind of yellow gold. It photographs weirdly. So I'm going to make it even darker, I think.
You're not going to stay with this sort of red? No? Yeah?
Oh, I don't know. I'm not a hair girl. They can do whatever they want to.
Just sit there and let it take over. It does have a lot of highlights in it right now, doesn't it? Yeah.
I like it. It's pretty.
And here's a straight word today.
Straighter.
It's they blew it out.
Yeah, they blew it out for the commentary, so it's very straight. But it's, you know, it's always straight. My son's hair is straight as a board, so I know.
Yeah.
He earned that. Yeah.
He got it from you. Yeah.
Yeah.
Somebody did an article in Self Magazine recently, and are you aware of that?
No.
And it was an article on women and their bodies and how.
Oh, I heard about this.
Yeah, it was actually supposed to be women in television, and because I was on Tarzan at the time, but we rang them up and went, look, to be honest with you, Tarzan's dead, you know, the show is over, so, you know, Lucy's just going to pull out, we wanted to be fair and tell you, and they came back and said, oh, well, we're going to change the slant, because this edition is all about women feeling great about their bodies, and I said, well, okay, you know, I guess I can, you know, support that. And then you do this article, and it's like, women shouldn't hide their stretch marks or whatever it was anymore. And they've got me hiding always completely behind this curtain. It was just like...
A shower curtain.
Yeah, all you women shouldn't hide your flaws, but, you know...
Here I
am. I'm perfectly happy behind the shower curtain.
So, I mean, what were you showing then?
Like, nothing. What?
Nothing at all.
Bit of kind hip of, and a bit of
hip,
bit of shoulder.
Okay.
It was kind of funny, but so the photographer, she's a wonderful photographer. I worked with her years ago, and
is she a New Zealander?
She's originally German, works in New York now, and she took some photos that were just showed too much. You know, she's saying, now hold the shower curtain against you, sort of thing. And I said to her, look, to be honest with you, because she was going, oh, look at these Polaroids. I said, to be honest with you, since this has nothing to do with the article, I'd rather they just didn't exist. No, I know what you're going for, artistic, blah, blah, but not me. Wrong person, sister. So,
That's so funny.
Editor was there and she agreed, you know, that was not the brief that the photographer was given.
You can see through the curtain,
but
right?
She took the Polaroid. She took it home. She scored that one.
And where is that now?
She actually took scrapbook. The Polaroid. She didn't. Click the Polaroid.
She clicked it and she took it.
Jeez. Woohoo.
Someday.
Have we seen that?
That Polaroid will show up in the Enquirer.
Because I know there were, you and I met that morning, and we were talking about that Jamie Lee Curtis article in More Magazine, where she posed in just her underwear and no makeup, and I thought that's what they were going for.
We love that. I loved her doing that. Just,
Take the mask off
Hollywood, you know.
Okay.
And it's great. It's really freeing for other women to see images that aren't completely made up and airbrushed and, you know.
So the other ladies that had their picture taken, were they a little more kind of less glamorous or?
You know, I looked through them.
No. They looked They looked
still,
fantastic.
Still polished.
Yeah. It wasn't a case of just putting a newspaper in front of something.
Right.
They were really trying to make the whole.
Yeah, the Portia de Rossi one was kind of a beautiful photograph. But, I mean, I didn't really get the whole spread, to be honest.
It didn't seem to be making the point that.
Yeah.
Right. Right. They were really making it too artistic. And
Right.
Yeah.
That's right. That's what was wrong with it, perhaps. Not that it's my business to say, not my magazine, but if you're going to make women feel good about themselves, your readership, stop sticking glam images in front of them.
Then the naturalness should be good, should be beautiful enough, like Mary Steenburgen's face, which is what we were talking about earlier. It's not, you know, her face wasn't all de-wrinkled and de-whatever, you know, her face looks, you know, she's...
Real.
Yeah. Like I don't know how old she is.
That's a good word.
And moving north, speaking of women, You've been in Toronto recently, and it was, you said, it came back saying it was really, the people and the women up there were really different.
Yeah, I think, well, compared to LA, they were exactly what we're talking about. These women are, you know, they're full-bodied and they're, I feel like in LA everybody's sort of having water for lunch and, you know, trying to pare themselves down, and everybody's sort of looking out for the next step up. You know, this is a work town. And in Toronto, people are living their lives and they're comfortable where they are and who they are, and they just walk slower. Or they're not looking for the next move, the next gambit, you know.
Did you notice that more among the women than the men?
No, the men too, but it's just more evident that the women are rounder, just really natural and kind of fabulous, I thought.
It's funny because I went to Barcelona recently. I think it was back in August.
Just going to tell
you
that.
And I definitely get a sense of, that the city was slower than Los Angeles. You know, the people were more in love. They were connecting with other people. When I say in love, you know, that's where I saw everybody kissing. It's beautiful. But no, they were connecting and there was no agenda in their lifestyle.
Well, people drive everywhere here too, so we're not
connecting. Yeah, sure.
Yeah, yeah, you just don't interact with other human beings so much.
And then if you do try to, you're in a car here and you just look at someone else waiting in their car, then they get sort of defensive and nervous, you know.
Yeah.
So, well, it's weird. It's really strange.
Like that guy who was...
The windshield.
Yelling out the window at you when you were driving.
Oh, yeah.
You were talking on the phone.
God. I was going to see Sharon, and I was on my way over there to the creation office, and this man was behind me, and I was trying to get onto the freeway, and he just kept honking at me, and he was trying to go around me, and he was really angry. There's nothing I could do, right? I have to get on the freeway. So I start to get on the freeway, and he's still trying to get around me. So I just... So, can I tell what I did?
Sure.
I flipped him off in my rearview mirror. I did. I was really angry. And actually, I wasn't that angry. I was... So anyway, yeah.
Well.
Okay. Anyway, so, okay, so this is what happened. So I'm like, you know, shut up, you know, and in my mirror. And I didn't know who I was dealing with. So basically, this guy came around me. Now we're in the first lane of the highway.
Now he's angry and it's personal.
He was pissed. He got in front of me, slammed on his brake. So I had to completely stop.
Great.
Yeah. And I just thought, okay, maybe I'm not going to be talking to this guy. So I try to go around him. He swerves in front of me.
No, he's got road rage.
Whoa, it was so frightening. He slammed on his brakes again. And I, for an instant, my life flashed, and I thought, I'm going to die by this asshole. I couldn't believe it, you know? Like, this was such a...
Oh, my God.
And I swerved into the fast lane. And then, luckily, I just happened to be, you know, God was looking out for me and just happened to be open. But that
scared
me.
Wow, that's terrible.
She was shaking when she came to the office.
I was shaking. I was wired.
Yeah.
Because road rage.
Yeah,
had,
I never
he
really...
He was taking it out on you, whatever's going
never
on.
Never experienced it. And it was this really expensive car, you know, with this personal license plate and this really angry man. And I was pissed off. I was shaking. Yeah, I'm shaking now.
Yeah.
But yeah, anyway.
Wow.
Learned a lesson then. You know, you never know who you're dealing with in LA.
And just let jerks go around you.
I'll let jerks
go
around.
Get ahead.
Yeah.
And get some distance on you.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, it's not worth it.
So dangerous, you know, but it was interesting to see how angry it made me, you know. So then I'm like, okay, you know, and it's just, you know, let go. Jeez.
Wow,
next time,
awful.
Keep your hands in your lap. No
yeah,
more
I know.
No more.
Sharon and I were laughing. Next time I'll do one of these, you know, or if I have to, or all this,
it
you know.
The same. It was the same. I don't
okay.
know.
What I was saying.
I'll
saying.
Do this. That was better.
Or
yeah,
this.
Sharon was trying to get me to do this.
Just this one really annoying.
I know. How's it going? Oh, no, I just thought this man's going to kill somebody one day if that's how he reacts to people, you know?
Yeah.
It's a shame.
Yeah.
You've got a wicked sense of humor. Just smile.
Just smile. Act stupid.
Oh, man.
Hi.
Did you enjoy your day as a wedding cake bride?
Yes.
When were you a wedding cake bride? What's that?
I'm taking this class, this acting class right now, and... it's every Wednesday night, and every 6 weeks we have to do variety night. And we have to either sing a song or do a dance or a monologue that we have to write. So it's basically our interpretation of characters that we want to play that we would never have an opportunity to do.
What a great idea.
It's, oh God, it's so challenging. And the people in the class are so creative that you just feel this like bar that's set, that's something you have to rise up to
keep
picking
it up,
keep it
up.
Kick it up.
Yeah.
So there's a theme every now and then, and this was around Valentine's Day. And our teacher, Julie, said that it had to be around love. So you could either be Cupid or Valentine or a character that embraces universal love. So I...
Are those your three choices? That's all you get?
Yeah, that's all you get for this week, that week. And so I went through my closet, which is interesting, and I found this costume that was from Xena. It was from the mermaid episode, the one that where she's a bride and marries Ted, you know?
Yeah, that's
cute. I've got the bosoms, I've got all the flowers around and the shawl. So I found that, and I thought, I'm going to be a bride. And I was trying to think, what else could be unusual about this? So I decided to make her a little porcelain doll on top of the wedding cake. Do you know what I mean? And actually animate her life. So I made her a French porcelain doll that came from France that has now been brought to America. And she is this muse that the baker uses to create all of his cakes. So I sort of, that was my monologue of, you know. Anyway, it was funny, though, because here it was supposed to be about love, you know, and it was supposed to be chirpy and happy, and I was doing it, and I kept going, oh, my God, this is actually really sad, because I'm this inanimate object that cannot be with her love, and it was like, whoa, and it just kept coming over me, and I thought, oh, no, it was really interesting.
What reaction did the people, the audience, have to it?
They thought it was very creative, you know.
Given that you're saying one thing and feeling something different, what was their reaction? What was the message were they getting? Because it didn't strike you that it was sad.
I know. Right? It's funny because the way we work the class is that it has to be positive. The feedback from the class has to be positive. Right. The teacher can draw out more expansive, you know, analysis. But the thing is I didn't let my character address that because I'd already written my monologue, and my monologue didn't address the sense of detachment, you know? So it's really interesting. So I'm feeling these things and thinking, oh, this is actually really sad, but my monologue was going in a completely different way. So I had like this veneer of like this, you know what I mean? Like this porcelain thing. And yet the undertones were like completely different. It was really interesting to see.
Wow. I would have loved to have seen that.
Yeah.
It would have been interesting to hear from the audience.
You know what I would
Whether they found it a pathos or whether they found it amusing. Because the initial description when you started talking about it was that this is funny.
But what's great about this class is it's all about acknowledging that. And if I had just acknowledged it, I could have, you know, since she was sad, maybe she would start crying. You know, actually, I had part of my monologue is that she envisions their wedding. And she talks about, you know, what will happen, the music that'll be playing, and so I could have done that. It threw me. It's funny.
I would love to have seen that. Yeah,
those are fun nights, though.
Well, that's typically. But what I'm picking up, what I heard there, which was surprising, is that so here you are acting a character, and your insides are absolutely, entirely, emotionally someplace else, and yet you kept the facade going, you kept the speech going.
Well, you have to do that.
Turns up in acting.
Oh, it happens all the time, don't you think?
All the
subtext, there you go.
Right.
Of your, yeah, happens all the time. Yeah. These are the words you have to deliver.
But what you're feeling could be completely different with the other actor, yeah, what's actually happening. I love those scenes, though, because they're so interesting to watch. It happened recently. Oh, in the movie, the Sean Penn movie, Mystic River. Remember, I don't know if you saw it. Did you see that?
No,
with Tim Robbins coming up the stairs to his wife. She was great. I forgot her name. Anyway, it's funny because he's talking to her and he's really concerned in the dialogue, but it's actually a really menacing approach to her, and you just sort of feel threatened by her. But his dialogue is completely
threatened
different.
By her or
the,
by
the,
him?
That she was feeling threatened by him. You can see in her face. But his dialogue was, you know, what's wrong with you thinking I'm a bad person? You know, he's very sort of. It was a weak dialogue, like he's the victim, yet he was not. He was,
ooh,
I know.
That was no accident.
I know, exactly. It was really clever directing, and it was really good.
And a perfect actor to use it with. Yeah,
it's really
And the end of the doll, what does she do at the end?
Had a little tiny little mariachis that were our Miles's.
They were like us.
Mariachi, you know, the little shake.
Oh, yeah.
So I had these tiny ones that Miles used, but I had stuffed them in that great big bra because I had a lot of room. I flicked them out, and so I'm doing a little mariachi dance. And then my character.
You're such a nut.
I know. And then my character basically, the whole point of the speech is that she's teaching all the other girls when they can take their breaks. Like, you can have your cigarette now. You know, this is what you do when you're 5 minutes while the guy's outside, the baker. So anyway, yeah. I suddenly was interrupted by the baker man coming in, and she had to get back in place for the display.
And her dream is one day.
Yeah. I'd like to see it rewritten.
With the other.
Yeah,
the
dropping all the baker and all that stuff.
Just about,
you know, about her trying to keep the facade, but knowing that the audience knows the inside. So that's always that. It's what we were talking about in one of those scenes where.
Yeah, but how do they know what's really happening to her?
Because it can't help but show.
Showing her, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, that's good. Mm. It's funny because I'm trying to find ways to write my own monologues for, you know, like a show. I don't know what the theme will be. Who knows? But to find these little moments of different characters that I can bring to life. So I'm playing with that. That's a good one. I'll try that.
We snuck you into the... How was it like being on the other side and sitting among all those fans and they didn't know you were there?
I loved the opportunity to get to see Renee doing it when she didn't know I was there. Nobody knew it was I was there. And I loved seeing Renee do things I'd never seen her do before in all the years we'd been working together. So it was neat to see an artist having grown and, you know.
Yeah, thank you. Wow.
And doing those other characters too, because the Western ones had an authenticity that other people wouldn't be able to do. So, and I liked the writing too, because it was very specific.
But I didn't write those, you know.
No, you didn't write those. Right. But it was very specific. I didn't always know, you know, I didn't know where it was going to go quite often. And that's quite rare. You know, when somebody dares to be really specific, it has amazing commonality with the audience. So that was the great thing about that writing. Even though I didn't know him, like the scene where the mother was dying, mm-hmm. she talked about very, they seemed very, that it was so detailed that it had to kind of be true. You know, you go, oh, wow, I never would have thought of that. Or, oh, wow, is that what they did? How interesting. It wasn't cliched. So
that is very good, isn't it? With the writing,
choice. Yeah, it was a good
right. I mean, definitely
piece, and yeah, I loved seeing you do it.
I was thinking of bravery, the courage of taking the time for the silences, like at the end of the marble piece. You picked up the marble, and it's like beat, beat, and then you just held it up and said, "Makes the day go longer." And that long silence then when you've got to control the audience, the bravery to go ahead and take that long pause.
It's different.
It's much harder when you're doing theater because...
Do you think? I was going to say the opposite. Wow.
Really?
Yeah.
But letting a scene breathe in film is an editor and director's choice.
Yeah, you're
when
right.
When it's theater, it's just you and your instinct and your impulse when to move on and to dare not to. Because when I did theatre doing vagina monologues, there were performances where I was completely freaked out and would just keep going on too fast because I didn't let it breathe.
Mm-hmm. Why were you freaked out?
Well, theatre's just the scariest thing on the planet.
Okay, just because of where you were, right?
Yeah.
Right. It wasn't the particular pieces you were doing? Or...
Well, it was, you know, it was... I had a couple of pieces I didn't really believe in and wouldn't have chosen except nobody else wanted them.
Oh, really?
Wow. Yeah, and you know, I'll kind of go, oh, okay, I'll take whatever you give me. Well, I'm learning not to be like that.
This
is helpful.
I've learned that too.
Because, yeah, you will just get screwed.
Yeah. You've got to connect. That's what the one piece I didn't connect to in this that I had chosen for myself was the actress in the 15 minutes, the beginning.
You did?
I did.
Really? I liked it so much.
I connected with the audience when I bring up the lights.
Right.
That I connected to. But from the very beginning, brushing the hair, talking about these directors, up until that point, I didn't connect with her. And I wish I had not done that monologue. Isn't that
really?
Funny? Mm. But what I needed to do was I needed it because I really loved breaking the fourth wall and, again, embracing everyone.
And when you looked over our way when the lights came up, I had to quickly bring my camera up to my eyes so that you wouldn't spot who I was.
That's funny. No, but I did enjoy doing that because the reason I like doing it for theater is because you can feel the room. You know, you can feel when people are there or if they're not. You know, you get a sense of movement. But with the camera, yeah, like you said, I can't feel unless it's with the other actor when there's like a, you know, that moment of pausing because there's something too much. You know, you got to wait to really breathe until you move on. And I don't know.
I think it's far more courage required in and generosity required in performing on stage than.
Film. Well, I wish I knew how to hold the.
Me too. Me too. But that's film. The thing. You
can't think about it.
And you get better and better. So a 50-year-old actress has got to be better than a 25-year-old actress.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So more parts for older women.
Bring them on. Bring them on.
Definitely.
Did you go up in the lines at all during the play?
Yes, I did. Did I lose track of lines? Oh. It's funny because the whole thing, you know, I only had the 3 weeks to learn these monologues, and I was really afraid before I went out that I was going to forget it all. You know, the whole feeling of feeling disconnected. I could not remember a thing. I really couldn't. I thought, you know what? I better not even try.
Right.
That feeling of hit it, you know what I mean? I was too worried about trying to do that. So I just relaxed and then did what I, you know, tried to go in the next room to get a bottle of water. Everyone blocked me, trying to hide you. They're like,
Lucy got shoved in the chest. She was walking right behind me and I just stuck out my hand and I didn't know where it was going to land, but at least it was going to keep her at arm distance.
But I know it was Lucy. It was just like this woman with this like mop of a wig on. Now that I know it was a wig, a mop of hair. And everyone's trying to keep me out of the room. I'm like, what's going on? But
Did you get photos of that?
We got film footage. There was a guy in there, so you got the whole thing of you getting shoved back in, and then you can see her little head, you know,
peeking really? Her out.
Oh, that's funny.
What's going on in there?
Oh, that's funny.
And what I thought was really ironic is that we had you, you know, that area backstage is black curtains in the front. Yeah. And then there's actually three sections, the section where Adam and all the technical equipment is.
And they kept trying to hide me, and you'd keep walking into the very next, just, you know, inches away through the
right.
curtain.
Yeah, when you were standing over there and Chris was photographing
right.
you, she was standing on the other side
that's
of the black
so
curtain.
Funny.
And at one point, Chris moved to stand between, and he has his camera going back and
great.
Forth like this, so you can actually see.
Oh, that's funny.
That's
what a great shot he
that
caught.
Is a great shot.
Oh, I loved it. Now, you didn't want to get out of character when she... Who was this character, anyway?
I don't know. It was Pat, you know, from SNL. I don't know. It's just once you're in the zone...
That was your jacket, right?
No, it was actually belonged to a woman backstage.
Oh,
we just... Dad. I was there with my girlfriend.
Yeah.
Laurie and Karen and they were sort of helping me come up with ideas, and then all we had to do was look around us and go, you know, gotta
that's
have the
great.
Asthma spray or the lipstick. And my girlfriend who's gay said that lesbians always carry chapstick because they don't wear lipstick and their lips are always chapped. And so
that's great.
Of course I had to it's my socks. Did not blow my nose on my socks. I might need them later.
Did you find your tissues? Are they hiding under the
I don't know. I'm working on this. Oh, this has got... Look,
that
this has got
gone.
Bloody
ugh.
Days of good blowing left
all
in there.
Right. If we got napkins yeah. back there, someone can throw them over the screen before Lucy starts... I thought there
no,
were
I,
more tissues.
No, I do have them. Yeah, they're here
oh, you
somewhere.
Did find them? Oh, okay.
Well, just...
You just keep finding
I've lost
the tag
them, that's
of
all.
The... Somebody's got a cold.
Yeah. It's such
that's
a cold,
funny.
Boy.
Yeah.
Oh, sneezy. And you know, you sat there thanks. When she pulled that thing off and you said...
I know, it was like show was over then.
I don't like this.
Why?
Because you had your idea of the character and I couldn't relate to you. Remember we talked about that.
I know, I could see Renee was sort of holding back because it's like...
Really?
Oh, yeah. Because her hair was in her eyes. I knew it was Lucy, but I couldn't really see it was Lucy, and so I didn't really know... I didn't know what was going on. I knew it was Lucy, but I couldn't, hold on a conversation with the character.
I knew the audience was shouting to, you know, take the wig off, and then you were saying, oh, I'll go ahead and take it off, too. And I thought, that's interesting.
Yeah.
So you couldn't relate to
it.
You couldn't find your friend in there.
I guess because I asked you a question, like, what you've been doing, you said photography. I was like, really?
No.
That's right, because I was being the character.
The character.
And not
photography. That was funny.
The voice.
And it was so funny when... Because every time, at an appropriate moment, when like in between the monologues or something, that I'd get up and go, "Oh, Would you really?
Renee, like I was just like,
really?
Your biggest fan.
Did you really?
You could hear the whoop whoops on the phone. Funny. I did not know that was you.
That was
you
me.
Hear it on the film.
Wow.
Somebody going whoop, whoop.
I didn't hear anybody yell whoop.
I love you, Renee.
How could I miss that?
We love you.
Which is a Michael Jackson. Oh, I had music on in between each monologue, maybe.
Yeah, and it was kind of, it was appropriate
that
moments.
Loud?
I wouldn't
was
do it.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah, it was pretty loud.
And everyone else was cheering.
Was it the end then, huh? At the end, maybe?
Yeah, I was just yelling louder than everybody else. Because it was fun. It was like, that's what this character would do.
Yeah.
What's it like to kiss Lucy Lawler?
You would have had to dip my character, because she would have just been freaking out at the nearness of you.
I can't believe I'm going to be kissed by Renee.
What's her name, Pat?
I don't know. Pat was the SNL character.
No, I know,
I didn't really go as far as getting a name. But I've got all these photos at home because there was nobody but home but you know me and the kids. So I have to take photos of myself with a digital thing so I can see what I look like with different wigs on. And then anyway, I
tried a few. That wig is wild. Where did you get that wig?
It's a crazy wig, eh? Some little shop in New York.
That's funny.
That's a $15 wig.
It's really funny.
Dreads.
Gosh.
Do you guys feel like you're hams on stage?
I do.
Together, I feel.
Yeah, we're hams together.
Yeah.
It's like much more fun when you're in character, though.
Yeah, when you're in
when
a
you're
character.
In character.
Not
yeah,
Zena,
in a character. Because,
right.
I don't know, there's no holds barred. When you're being yourself, you've got all your manners and everything your mother taught you and what you think they need to hear. When you're a character, that character's free to flout all those rules.
We have pictures of you on, we've got the video of you doing Huzgar Khan, getting your tattoos put on, and we now have a few shots of you. How, by the way, how were those tattoos put on your body for that last piece?
They were decals. Decals similar to the Mindy that we used to use, you know? I think you found them in New York, right?
Yeah.
At a shop in New York, and we put them on with some water. No, it was alcohol, sorry. And then backstage, I wanted to color them in because I wanted them to pop a bit more from...
Oh, they were nice, too. They were good tats.
Well, that's
they
good.
They were pretty good.
They were black and white, but then... Good job. But then I had Catherine Fugier and Missy Good...
Myself, Wendy.
And Wendy all taking a marker and just basically coloring in the tattoos. Mm-hmm. And I knew I didn't have much time, so I said, okay, we're going to just pick a color, pick a tattoo, do whatever you want, you know, and let's just... I needed, 10 minutes or something and be done with it. And they had fun.
So what I'm thinking about it. But I noticed basically she's simply standing there. Now, you're used to doing that at work. Now, here we're kind of a bunch of regular strangers, although we were all people that you did know. But actresses have that done all the time. We've seen that in the sessions today that, you know, some... Is that an easy thing to do when you started, or is that something you have to learn to do to sort of...
It's funny, because I thought that... it would be really easy and no big deal. And so I was there, and I do know, you know, like Missy and Catherine and you and Wendy pretty well. But I found, and it did take me back to Zena, the whole thing of being sort of there, and you're just sort of in your music at 6:30 in the morning and waiting while they're finishing the makeup, right? But there's a reason you start to get detached from your body. You sort of, I find.
Yeah.
You start to kind of leave it, you know what I mean? And your mind goes elsewhere. And I had to really... fight against how I felt after that happened to get back into getting ready for the show, because the whole show for me was all about being in my body and sharing everything I could with everybody.
Huh.
So yeah, it took me a minute just to go, what the?
Get your head in the right space.
Where am I?
You know? Did you find that natural starting when you first started acting, and all of a sudden you have to sit there and
have people fussing on you all the time? After all, there were times in the beginning, I think, where it was like, oh, you know, please get that cold yucky sponge away or something.
But
after a while, you don't even notice them.
But that's because your mind leaves for me. Like I would just think of something else, you know?
Yeah, just get over and done with.
Yeah.
It's not a big deal.
The freedom of fighting. Adrian, I was talking to Adrian about her first day on set, Adrian Wilkinson, and she had to do fighting, and it was difficult. That's not something she had ever done in real life, and she never did that kind of a part. From like, your time.
I remember that for her first day, actually.
From your first time on Hercules, it looked like the freedom to be a strong fighter was there. Did you Am I seeing that correctly, or were you timid when you started to do that? And he said, okay.
I guess that's why I got the job, really. I'd ask Rob. I come from a family with a lot of boys, and we did a lot of wrestling, and physical freedom was never a problem for me. People might have encouraged me to try to be a lady, but I don't remember it. Never stuck, so yeah. It's much easier for me to act aggressive than it is for me to be, you know, soft. And
so if you had a part where
problem, really.
Stop. Is that shit?
Well, no, sometimes it is, because if I'm really uncomfortable, I'll come off like a smart ass sometimes instead of just being myself. Yeah. If I feel like I'm in a hostile environment,
right,
or something.
You have to be defensive.
Yeah, I'll be defensive and even if I don't need to be.
It's funny because I'll get quiet. It's interesting.
Mm.
Yeah.
When it gets loud, when it gets quiet.
Yeah, I'll get
and
quiet.
And you get quiet when she was the loud one on the characters.
It's the exact opposite.
On the character. Oh, the
Gabrielle was the loud, noisy one, and you were quiet.
Really?
That I was loud
and
noisy?
Butch. You were loud, noisy, and butch.
It was all in the hair.
It was all in the hair. Lucy said, directing is about control and acting is about surrender. Agree, disagree?
I agree. I think acting is definitely about surrendering and exposing your heart. And then directing is about being intellectual and controlling the environment and controlling performances and almost like...
Clock watching.
Clock watching.
Compromising.
Compromising.
Letting go of your vision.
All
the thing about acting
want
is
to do
that
it.
For the most part, you're at the very end of the line,
yeah,
and you can pretty much do whatever you want within, you know,
you can,
the parameters of your character.
Mm. But don't you think you're still at the, you're still at the mercy of, like you said, the director, the editor, the producer. So even though you give a performance that you might feel really good about, it could be edited out.
It's true.
Completely cut to pieces and have a whole different performance on camera, in the film. So it's interesting. So you're still exposing yourself, but you never know.
Right.
What you're going to get.
Well, I'm only there for that moment and then...
Right.
Totally let it go, you know.
But you do it for the... just that one moment. That was interesting.
That's what I was going to say. So the free...
I realized what it is with me, that I live in the moment.
Right.
Which means sometimes which is why I can't remember things that happened 2 seconds ago. I don't have anecdotes for the most part.
Right.
And it means I make some really big mistakes because I only... think about things retrospectively. I don't, you know,
I don't plan
anything in life.
God, I love that, Lucy.
Yeah.
That's my goal, to live in the moment.
Yeah. Well, we've got to meet somewhere in the middle and cross over a little.
Take a little from each other.
Yeah. Because sometimes it works out great, but sometimes it's a complete disaster. And I just bounce from fiasco to fiasco in my life.
God, see, I would love to have that freedom. That's what I'm trying to learn, is not to plan my future, you know what I mean? Not to have a plan in my career or anything, you know, just live for people around me and enjoying every experience, you know?
Mm.
So you're worrying about the past and the future and missing out on the minute.
I can't
And you're
be.
Enjoying the heck out of the minute. And
or not enjoying, but I mean, just I'm right
yeah.
there.
But the thing is that you go in and out of that. You know, I'm not always like that. Yeah. But I mean, there are definitely, I'd say recently, more about living, you know, planning things instead of just embracing, you know.
Mm.
How fun. That's interesting.
That's why I can never plan things ahead either. I can think kind
like
of
that.
In terms of the next week. But if Rob says, May 8th, keep in mind, May 8th, something really important is going to happen. May 8th might as well be 10 years away. I'm not going to worry about it now.
And I'm not like that at
all. Yeah, you can't book in with me 2 weeks ahead.
God, and I love to know what I'm doing.
Yeah.
Like 3 months. No, I'm kidding.
Yeah.
If you guys had been at a party for a mutual friend but had never met each other, do you think you would have started talking with each other for past hello and how are you? You think you might have... Because you're so different.
Yeah, I don't think so. Not initially. Like, if we didn't know each other at all.
Mm, possibly not.
Yeah. What a shame.
But now you just go,
absolutely.
Well, that's impossible.
Yeah. I'm. That's just that tendency to... I think I would
find
you.
Yeah, to look for like characters or something.
Yeah, like I would probably find you a bit intimidating because, well, no, seriously, because you're like, you're beautiful, you're smart, you know, and I probably would have just been a little quiet, maybe like a bit of a fanny, but I don't know. But, but yeah, I don't think I would approach you because I'm not that bold in who I am approaching people, especially if
right,
I know
and if people aren't
you've got
perhaps out there.
Yeah.
I'm just not going to notice them.
Absolutely.
Blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
Are you bold going up to strangers? We're talking about this Eurotrip premiere party,
definitely.
And I tried twice to go up and talk to people, and I really wasn't, you know, of any value to them, so they kind of turned
that's
away.
That's L.A., though. That's L.A., right?
Yeah.
That's what I was talking about, Toronto. Not like that. Other parts of the States, not like that.
See, it's funny, but I remember you at the Emmys going up to people and just saying, hey, mate, you know, like your work is up.
And so I like, learned that off my daughter.
Really?
She is such a meeter and greeter.
Wow.
Hi, I'm Daisy Lawless. Like, she's like famous or something. I'm Daisy Lawless. You know, she'll just talk to anybody.
That's so funny. But then I took that from you. You know, I was like, oh, I actually like this. And I saw an actress that I liked at the Emmys. And I went up to her and said, you know, I really like your work. I just got shot down.
Man. No.
Really?
Yes.
Okay.
When
names.
The camera's names.
No,
we want
I'm not
going to
name names. But I just went.
What do you mean,
whoa.
Got shot down?
Just brushed off.
Dismissed.
I was dismissed. Not, didn't know who I was, or not that I'm, you know, but like not important in her world. And I went, wow. You know, I don't take it to heart. The thing is that it is what it is. It's Hollywood, and I'm sure these people.
That's right. Everybody's looking for currency. And it's weird.
Yeah, right. Yeah. And agendas. I suppose that they feel like people are coming up to them. Wanting something from them as well, you know, and so maybe I was just someone else wanting to ask her to do a script of mine or whatever. I don't know. Who knows?
Right.
But I like those experiences though because it's just those are so surreal, you know.
Yeah, because they're real.
They
I know. I find that
because
people are nice to you if you're on television, you get a false sense of the world. And when I'm on the phone or, you know, quite often people don't recognize me really, but if people are really rude to me, I just go, oh my God, is that how people behave to one? And it's kind of like, I'm in a perverse way, I'm really tickled pink because
it's
you've got to laugh at them, you know, just,
yeah,
wow, you're so damn mean.
So I've been reading books about women trying to find themselves. I got a whole batch. We got city girls going to the country, to the sea, to the woods. Wives and mothers going off on their own, single women joining communes, working women going to the farm, farm women going to work. It seems like a whole lot of women don't know what they want in life. Did you have certain, how would you compare yourself before Xena and after in terms of your life and possibly your life as a woman? Too much for that?
Oh, that's a big question.
I know. I'll take like 5 minutes to take stock, right?
I'm much calmer now. Mm-hmm. My husband's over there going, don't have quite so much to prove to other people, but still as much to prove to myself.
This,
not done.
This. The same things you wanted then are still some things that you want now?
Yeah, yep.
Mm-hmm. Wow, geez. It's funny because it's similar to what we were talking about before where I think I had a plan, you know. I've always known what I wanted to do in my life. Like when I really embraced wanting to get into television, I luckily landed Xena. Like I've really been sort of open to experiences, which is really funny, and just open to things that happen, and I don't know, maybe it's been a blessing. But now, since the show ended, it's the first time I've never known what I wanted to do with my life. I didn't know if I wanted to be
free fall.
Yeah, absolutely. Didn't know if I wanted to be an actor, didn't know how to have this new role as a mother and be good at it, since I didn't know, you don't want to be good, right?
Yeah.
And so all these experiences, completely life-changing. But now I love just living for today, every day. So I think that's different for me. As a woman, I have a whole new sense of self and that I can live in the present and, yeah.
Can you spend time by yourself or do you need the stimulation of other people? Country girls or city girls?
take that question anyway.
I think I'm a country girl. And when I get into one of those situations we're talking about where I feel like, am I in a hostile situation? You know, when you audition, quite often you feel like, oh, I'm in a hostile situation, which is just so wrong. They want you to be good.
Absolutely.
You know? But I just feel like a total bumpkin. I should go back to the farm, deepest, darkest New Zealand.
But you mean, would you prefer to spend time alone then, or with people? Is that another?
Yeah, there's two options.
Are you more, or are you both?
Oh, I'm quite social.
Yeah. See, and I'm more, what is it, country or city?
I don't know. Country girl or city girl?
I'm more, I like to spend time alone. It's funny, I like to, I mean, I love being around my friends, but typically I know if I haven't spent time alone that there's something wrong in my life. I feel like I'm disconnected in some way. So it's interesting. I have to have that.
Got to be alone to plan and analyze.
Probably.
Go back.
No. God, don't leave me on my own. Otherwise, I'll have to think. I'll have to hear myself talk.
No, I love that. I love that time of introspection. You know, I analyze too much. So that's probably what I'm doing.
Okay, what's the most recent thing you cooked for yourself?
A roast chicken with a sauce from New Zealand from Wild Appetite.
Let's throw it.
A shameless plug. No, it was like this sauce. It's made from red capsicums, which are red bell peppers, you know. And it tastes like the sauce for buffalo wings. That's what it reminds me of. So I put it all over my chicken with garlic and put it in the oven.
Is that like barbecue sauce? The Americans call barbecue sauce?
No, this is, it's from New Zealand, from Wild Appetites, Matakana bell pepper sauce. And it's a red bell
pepper. Matakana bell pepper sauce?
Yeah.
From Wild Appetite, you say? Yeah.
One more time. But,
spell it out. What's the web page?
No. No, yeah, but anyway, that was the last thing I cooked. Not bad.
Oh. Well, I'm not big on cooking. My husband recently got back from 6 weeks in New Zealand, which was a relief because the kids just wouldn't stop whining that they don't like beef jerky for dinner every night.
Pop-Tarts for breakfast.
I mean, on the bright side, we've all lost 10 pounds.
So what's the problem?
Yeah. And I found that you can make a very credible mint choc chip by using chocolate sprinkles and toothpaste.
Great. So. Very credible.
Spearmint flavor comes through.
So my kids are happy that their father's home.
Well, girls, what music are you playing here? What's next on your machine?
Hang on, let's have a look. My favorite one is this one. Oh, come on.
Wait, which there button do you think you're
No, we're good.
You got?
Is it playing? Oh, bugger.
Bugger,
bitch bum.
Oh.
Number six. Here we go. This one's for you.
You don't own me. I'm not just one of your blue toys. You don't own me.
I forgot the words already.
Other boys. And don't tell me what to do. And don't tell me what to say. And please, when I go out with you, don't put me on display. You don't know me. Don't try to change me.
Right now.